Okay, do you hear me well? Yeah, good, okay. So you might be thinking that in order to improve performance of the website, we need to focus on the backend stuff, right? So we need to optimize or make the SQL queries more efficient. We need to go for the cache implementations and stuff like that. But in reality, there are actually several things we can do on the frontend itself to make it more performant. And this inspired me to basically take the topic of image optimization for today's presentation, as it is, in my opinion, one of the quick wins for improving performance in your website. So as Dom already introduced me, my name is Jakub, and I work at Vue Storefront. And I'm also a Google developer expert in web performance. This is also one of the reasons why I selected the topic. And I'm also ambassador in those organizations. So if you're interested in talking about any of them, just find me after the talk and we can just share the knowledge. And yeah, talk about it. And as Dom also mentioned, we met almost two years ago on the last edition of Vue.js Live. So I'm pretty happy to be here once again and yeah, share my knowledge with all of you. So I will start the presentation with a little poll. So please raise your hand if you are using images in your website. That's basically really straightforward, right? It's yes, we all are using the images in our websites. And now please raise your hand if you are optimizing the images. Okay, so quite a few of you, but not so many. So you can clearly see that we are all using the images, but we are not optimizing them. While optimizing images is, in my opinion, the crucial part of well-performing website. And it's not only about the results of the Lighthouse or any other web performance auditing tool. It's also good for user experience because users want to get the data as soon as possible. Like the images, if you are looking for e-commerce website, you want to have the product image as soon as possible because you want to buy the product. So let's talk about first about the image formats. So there are many technical differences between one image format and another. And in my today's talk, I wanted to focus on the optimization. So basically the size and the load time of the image. So I want to focus only on one. And yes, be prepared, there will be some more memes as well. For the users, the usual difference between one image, which is, let's say, in one format, and the other image, which is in different format, is usually the same. You can't see the difference. They just look the same. The only difference is the size. And this is what I will be showing during the short demo later on. But in general, formats such as WebP or AVIF, I hope I pronounce it correctly, are lighter than JPEG and PNG, but they are not supported by Internet Explorer. And I'm saying this because one of my friends until today is supporting application that still needs to be running on Internet Explorer. So, you know, he doesn't have a great job, I would say. Yeah, so we talked about the image formats. There are also cases about the size, properly sized images. And I have seen too many production websites where they were basically fetching the image, for example, for a small icon, and the image was in a full HD resolution, and then it was like squeezed into the icon that was, for example, in the footer. So this might seem like a, you know, really, really strange issue, but it happens too often, I would say, for the modern websites. So why should we have the images in a proper size? It's basically because the load time, if we are fetching the images in the right format, the load time will be shorter. And there will be also, what is the second most important thing, we won't see the layout shift. Because you will have, if you've seen some talks or articles about the web performance, you probably know already about the Core Web Vitals. This is like the metric or set of metrics that we can use in order to check the how our website is performing. So there are metrics such as first, largest contentful paint and cumulative layout shift. And having the properly sized images is important for both of them. But we can optimize those images by basically, you know, replacing the or converting the one of the image the images format into another one. We can just have the image in correct resolution from the very beginning. But in majority of cases, we want to be able to optimize them on the fly by using certain software. So for that, we can use image optimizing services. I'm not sure if there is a word such as this one or a keyword. I just made it up. So basically, the idea behind these services is to allow us to optimize the images on the fly. So whenever we need it and with the parameters that we need as well. So we can use the tool called IPX, which is the tool developed by the Nuxt team as well under the Nuxt organization. And the Nuxt organization in general, if you don't know it yet, it's an organization where there are packages that are used in many different frameworks because they are JavaScript / TypeScript only. So you can use it with Vue, React, So IPX is the image optimizer, which is based on Sharp and libvips. And it's really straightforward, the usage of it. We can just install it, and we can use it as the Express.js middleware, or we can use it as just the IPX client. And how we can use it later on in our application? We can just send the request to the localhost with certain parameters. For example, the format. In this case, it will be WebP. But the IPX works well, and actually it's used in the Nuxt image, the module that is widely used in the Nuxt ecosystem for handling images. However, there might be cases when we basically cannot use such a thing as IPX. We just want to have, you know, the third-party service handle this case for us. And for that, we can use a tool such as Cloudinary. So Cloudinary is the digital asset management that allows you to manage your assets of your website, so photos, pictures, videos, GIFs, many things like that. And then what we can do with it is we can fetch them in a way we want. So in the right format, in the right size, with many different optimization applied to, which I will show in a minute. So in Nuxt world, we can use Cloudinary with Nuxt image because Nuxt image supports 18 providers and Cloudinary is one of them. But we can also use the Cloudinary module, which is specifically for working with Cloudinary. That was developed by Maya Shavin. Maya Shavin is also popular in the Vue community. And she was the original creator of this module. And so you might be asking yourself, what is the reason, or basically what is the difference between using Nuxt image and the Nuxt Cloudinary, if they both can integrate with Cloudinary? So the idea behind Nuxt image is to be generic. So no matter what provider you will use, you can still use it with one API for the image. However, for the Nuxt Cloudinary, the idea was to deliver more functionalities from Cloudinary, more optimizations, more transformations, image transformations. And there is also one more difference in the Nuxt Cloudinary is that it was the module itself was developed some time ago, and it works only for Nuxt 2, which, as you know right now, Nuxt is transitioning into Nuxt 3. So I have a small surprise for you. And I was joining forces with Colby. Colby Fayok is the director of developer experience at Cloudinary. So we have joined forces recently to release a Cloudinary module for Nuxt 3. And I will show you that in a minute. So let me just go to the code. So the usage of the Cloudinary module is really simple. We just, as with many different modules as well. We just install the module, then we register it in the modules array. And then basically we just need to add the cloud name, the specific cloud name that is assigned to our account. And then what we can do is we can start using the CLD image, which is the component specifically created for working with Cloudinary. So as a result, what we have is that when we go to the localhost, this is the image that is fetched from Cloudinary. And if we inspect, by the way, is the font okay, visible? Okay. So as you can see, the type of the image is Aviv, because Cloudinary, by default, what the URL loader of Cloudinary will do is it will automatically try to use the most efficient image format. So in this case, it will be Aviv. So take a look at the size. It says 22.3 kilobytes for this image. And as you can see here, the SRC of the image is JPEG. So we already see the transformation being done. It was JPEG transformed into Aviv. So let's try to make it like a WebP. So here you see 22 kilobytes. And when I refresh, you see that changing to WebP increased the size by 15 kilobytes, more or less. So let's make it an original format, which will be JPEG, if I can type it correctly. So 33 kilobytes. Now it's 55 for the original one. So we already managed to get half of the size of the image by just using this format. And now let's go for PNG, just to show you the difference. So with PNG, PNG is 200 kilobytes. So basically 10 times bigger than the image in the Aviv format. But Cloudinary doesn't only allow you to change the format. It comes with many more functionalities out of the box. So let's say that instead of just changing the format, what I would like to do here is add some overlay to our image. So it will have some text, some styling as well. So when I uncomment it and just make it a little smaller, a little bit smaller, and refresh the page, you see what more can be added to the image. And this is being done fully by Cloudinary, and we can inspect that by checking the source of the image. You see here the full source of the image. So basically everything that we defined here in the code, the overlay, is being added as the parameters for Cloudinary to optimize the images for us. So yeah, the version 2.0 for the Cloudinary module for Nuxt is not yet released, but it will be in the next week. So with the rising popularity of Nuxt free projects, you will be able to use this module in the upcoming days as well. So let me come back to the slides, because I have a few more patterns that I wanted to share with you. And the first pattern that I always like to recommend and use in web applications is basically lazy loading, and specifically lazy loading of the images. So I can explain to you how it works, but I will show you a GIF with some cats that it will show you basically how it works. So we have the cats, images of the cats, and you can see in the requests queue that they are fetched basically when the user is scrolling down, so when they are actually needed. So instead of fetching all of them at the beginning, at the initial load of application, we can just defer them to the point that the user will see them in the viewport. And it can be done very easily. You can use the loading attribute of the image. You can also use packages such as Lozat or the intersection observer. But one small thing that I noticed recently in the Mozilla docs, that lazy loading or lazy value for the loading attribute of the image is explained as that the image will be loaded when necessary. So this is not entirely exactly true because, well, it is true, but it doesn't give you the full context of the lazy loading. Because what I noticed in many web applications, like production, and I will talk about it in a second, is that there are majority of web pages, or for example, e-commerce websites, that are lazy loading the largest contentful paint. So to give you more context, largest contentful paint should be delivered as soon as possible. And when we are using lazy loading, we are adding the request for this image to the end of the request loop, which basically makes it load longer. So here you also see the difference in the size of the images that are running on the website that is using web, lazy loading and not using, basically, as shown on the GIF with the cats. We can use it to defer loading the or requesting the images until the point they are actually needed. Lazy loading is part of what I call the lazy pattern, and basically I call it like that. I'm not sure if this is a pattern. And I'm really big fan of this pattern. This is me with two of my cats, the last lazy Sunday. So I'm a huge fan of it. And the idea behind having such a lazy pattern is to use the techniques that are related to deferring doing some functionality until it's actually needed. This is like I made this definition. So you can read about this lazy pattern in my dev2, in my article about improving performance of Nuxt with lazy pattern. And as a part of this lazy pattern, what it comes with is, of course, the lazy loading, as I mentioned, components dynamic lazy imports, lazy data fetching composables, and lazy hydration as well. Lazy hydration is a great package by Harlan, who is also a core team member of Nuxt. So you should check that out. What's next? There is also a fetch priority, which is an experimental feature that allows you to instruct the browser when it should fetch the request. So you can basically use it to tell the browser, okay, this one is super needed and it should be loaded as soon as possible. So we can just say for the, let's say the home banner or for a home page, we should use fetch priority to allow it to load as fast as possible. And we can do it very easily with the image tag. Just set fetch priority to high for the images that we want to fetch as soon as possible. And we can also instruct the browser to, for certain images to be fetched later on. So this is just the tip of the iceberg in improving performance, because there is a lot of things that we should take a look at. And I'm sure right after me will be Philip, who will be showing you some insights into web performance as well. And if you are interested more in learning more about this topic, so I have this series on dev2 about Nuxt performance, so Nuxt specific. And also recently I started writing about the web performance, so the usage of IPX, which I mentioned previously, the front-end web performance checklist, so things you should take a look at while trying to make your website more performant. And I have small final request to you to end my talk. By using optimized images, you basically deliver better experience to the users. This is cool because users like to be entertained. They like to get the cool experience. So who doesn't want to be cool, right? Okay, thank you very much for being here and listening to me. If you'd like to find me somewhere on the internet, you can search for Jacob Andrewski. It's easier to pronounce my last name in this way than in the original one. With the small difference in GitHub, I'm Baroshim. Yeah, thanks.